So we're here with Councilwoman Ana Sandoval talking about your the resolution that you put forward last week and was passed unanimously by City Hall, by all the City Council people, and that is about increasing public participation in San Antonio government. So what prompted that? Where did that come from?
Sure. So I would say it's a combination of a few things all happening at the same time, and Jeff Coyle from our Public Affairs Department calls it the perfect storm. So on the one hand, we have increased expectations from the public. We have a lot of technology available to us. We have people becoming experts on their own, finding information online, and there's an expectation of open and transparent government. The tools are there. Why aren't they posting this stuff online, number one? Number two is we're in a period of growth in San Antonio that's really, really rapid, right? It's growth like we've never seen before in our time living in San Antonio. So there's also an expectation of you've got to tell me what's coming before the crane hits the ground, before the dirt is being turned. So there's also an expectation that comes from that. And third is I come from a background of engaging the public. That's one of the things I did in my professional life before I was here on council. And there are just some best practices I learned along the way that go that can go a long way of building trust with the public and really empowering them in the decisions that we make in City Hall. So I think it was a number of those things.
And in full disclosure, I mean, Nowcast's nonprofit mission is to promote and facilitate an inclusive civic conversation. So it's kind of near and dear to our heart, and it's not something that I can pretend to be unbiased about. So.
So. And you're not.
No, I'm not.
No, clearly I'm not. I'm not either.
Yeah. And I heard it again last night at another neighborhood meeting. People said, hey, you know, by the time something gets to City Council, it's already kind of baked. And so if they don't have access to the planning meetings and they don't have access to HDRC meetings, or if they can't get in on any of those commission meetings, then it's gone and it's been decided.
Well, I mean, nothing is ever final, right, until the vote is taken. There are occasions when things change on the dais. But the truth is, the policy making doesn't only happen at the dais, right? It does happen in a lot of meetings, like you mentioned, so it's important to know them. One of the challenges that I had previously as a professional in this field, and even sometimes now, is it is sometimes difficult to engage the public early on in the planning process because you have so many other things competing for your attention. And unless you're really involved in the work of planning, you can't always see what the outcome means. What are the implications? So that's really where it's incumbent upon us, the city leaders, and also the city staff, to make that case about why it's important for you to participate in X, Y, or Z.
And tell me what you find as a person who is practicing it. Tell me what you find when you engage the public in things that, for instance, if you were a city staffer, you kind of thought you really understood what the answer was, and then you engage the public.
Right. Tell me.
So sometimes when you engage the public, do they come up with completely different perspectives on things? They come up with a different ramifications or unintended consequences and things like that need to be considered.
Right. Okay. Yes, you're getting at one of my key tenets for why I think it's important to do this is that engaging with the public isn't just about checking a box, right? We did this transparently, the public knows we're doing it, check. It's about the belief that the public has information that will help make this better. Whatever we're developing will help make it better. Now, we have to ask the right questions, we have to make the public feel comfortable in bringing things forward. So for instance, there could be something that's very helpful from the public is you'll know if you're using the right language, right, when you're talking to them, whether or not they get it or not, or based on the question. So that's important, right, is having the same language. They know details about their neighborhood and patterns of activity there that we won't always know from being here on the dais. Unless you live there day to day, you don't know those things.
So that's a big part of the input that they can give, and it's recognizing that it can be very valuable, and it can help prevent unintended consequences and help make a policy better.
Right, so my team and I talk about what are the best analogies that, that we can use in this discussion, and we've settled for the time being on it's public input is really the foundation of the policies that we're building. If we were to say all the policies we build are like buildings, we need that foundation at the bottom. Otherwise, we're going to have shifting of the building. You're going to have some deterioration later, and we don't want that. We want this building or this policy to stand the test of time. So we need to kind of test it out in the public by getting input. And public is not just residents of San Antonio. It's not just the homeowners or the renters, but the folks who are going to be affected by that policy in some way or other. It could end up being a business owner. It could end up being a landlord. But different people will bring different perspectives to the table.
Okay, so the city council unanimously passed this, which is terrific, and that suggests a bunch of shoulders behind this thing. So what happens next? Because this was a policy, right? This wasn't something that said, and if you don't, so what happens next?
Right, so we adopted it as a resolution. There are 10 principles in there, and I describe them as being a commitment from council to the public, saying, when we seek your input, we will follow these 10 principles, that we will be transparent, we will be inclusive, we will be accessible, and you can read more about those online. But what was really wonderful about what happened last Thursday is it wasn't just the presentation of the principles. There was actually a lot of meat that staff had been developing in the prior months since the almost year that we proposed the CCR. So they said, okay, we are going to have what's called an administrative directive, right? Something that comes from the city manager to all of staff saying, these are the minimum things you must do every time you have a public engagement process. Like, the materials must be in English and in Spanish. You must promote it on, you know, such and such channels. So that is coming forward. Another thing that's happening is the mayor and I are together putting together a public participation advisory committee. So the direction won't just be coming from myself or from staff, but we want to know, what does the general public think about this? So the types of people that we're looking to get engaged in that is folks that have been active with the city, and maybe folks that have not been active with the city, people who are social media influencers, just really a broad range of stakeholders whom we can run some of these issues by. You know, we all have blind spots, right? And I think they would bring expertise to the table. So that's one of the things that's coming up. Another thing that's already underway is we do have an umbrella website called SA Speak Up, where anything that's open for public comment will be posted. So it's kind of like a one-stop shop for the general public. Again, it does require the public to go look it up, right? But if you were perusing our website, at least it would be a little bit more convenient. Another proposal that we put forward as part of the CCR was live streaming our committee, our council committee meetings, planning commission meetings, zoning commission meetings. I think the public is really interested in seeing that happen. Even if they don't watch them, they want to know that that's available, right? Because it's a public meeting. And if you can't drop what you're doing in the middle of the day to go to that meeting, we're not really meeting that spirit of being a public meeting.
Absolutely. And then they meet at 1 o'clock on Tuesday afternoon every other Tuesday, and 1 o'clock on Wednesday afternoon every other Wednesday. And I say that from
experience.
Probably we have the most video of anybody of all of the planning and zoning and HDRC meetings. Yes, we do. But it was by popular demand. People begged us to go to those meetings because they couldn't.
Right. So staff is looking at what will that cost to be, and they will be bringing a proposal to council. Now, it will be up to council to decide, you know, do we put that money aside for that? I think it's a worthy investment, part of the cost of doing business, transparent business as a city government. And I think that's the one other thing that's coming up is we are looking at reimbursing people for parking or giving them some kind of bus pass for coming to participate in a meeting that's in the middle of the day when you have to pay for parking. And, you know, right now people will park at either on the street where your meter may expire, right, in 2 hours, and maybe your item doesn't get heard in that time. Or you go to the Frost building and you could end up spending $6 or $8, and that adds up, right? And
oh,
that's a barrier to participating in government.
Absolutely. absolutely. It's tough, even for those of us who know the secrets of downtown. You know,
you know where you are without paying.
Well, I mean, there's a lot that is a visitor lot that we're allowed access to, but you kind of have to know the secret password to get to that.
I don't even know the secret password.
Well, it used to be outside of City Hall before it was under renovation, and all of those parking spots were lost. So it's Plan C at this point. So, earlier I had seen Jeff Coyle, head of the Government and Public Affairs Department, quoted in the San Antonio Current saying he wanted to do a cost-benefit analysis of live streaming. And as somebody who's really been involved in civic engagement, what's the cost of not engaging the public?
Oh, that's a good question. So I think, you know, staff and even us, we have to be responsible stewards of the taxpayers' dollars. So I think that's probably kind of a go-to for our staff, right, is they have to say that, you know, what's the benefit going to be? In this case, it really may end up being more of a value proposition, right, is are we committed to transparency and accessibility? And then there's, as long as it's not breaking the bank, there will be a cost to that. So, and, you know, Jeff may come forward and tell us, you know, 500 people watch it or 1,000 people watch it, and it'll be up to us to say,
well, if they could find it, it would be a lot easier for them to watch it, and if it were easily accessible. And that's a very sincere, we also go online and capture city council meetings and put them on our YouTube channel because people cannot find them on the city's website. And so that, it's not necessarily the engagement. It's whether or not people even know where and
how accessible
right. It
is.
Right.
Correct.
Right. So, I mean, and it's sort of like the difference between Facebook Live and YouTube, right? So Facebook Live is inside of Facebook, and so you have to be a Facebook person to get to a Facebook Live. So how many people are you excluding when you do a Facebook Live, and how many people you're not making it accessible to, you know, when you do that versus when you do something on YouTube or outside of the walled garden? I mean, there's a whole lot of policy
questions. So, for instance, right now, I live stream my committee meetings, the ones that I chair, on Facebook Live, because it's a tool that's easily accessible to me at no cost,
right?
But I realize not everyone can join in that conversation. So we will look to the city to make some of those improvements. I think council, it sounds generally supportive of it. But you're right, the conversation's not over there.
Right.
Then, right?
It's
not
a more complicated conversation than, gee whiz, nobody watches it.
It
right?
is. So
I mean,
we
if the Wi-Fi in Central Library is blocking the city channel, that's also why people don't watch it, you know?
So these are the wonderful weeds that we will get into in the advisory committee when we go through each of these topics one by one. I think there's probably a top 10 or top 100 list, right, of things we can quickly and easily do to improve access to local government, and this is one of those discussions.
Right, okay. Well, and when we get back to cost and also, you know, what the city is capable of doing, obviously you were aware we did a report card that showed the top 10 cities in Texas, and even the smallest of the top 10 are better than San Antonio.
Laredo, right?
Laredo is kicking our ass on access to public records and meetings. So
thank you for putting that report card together. I think it's always good to have a third party do that evaluation, and a competition is always great too, right? There's a lot of city pride in San Antonio, but so the report card that you issued was shared with our staff internally, including the planning staff that puts together those committee packets, and there is, I think that was probably news to them, so they are currently evaluating how they can improve that packet to make it more helpful. I think sometimes things have just been done a certain way for a long time, and we don't stop and reevaluate. So it's perfect. This is what nonprofits are supposed to do, right? Is help us do our job better. And that's what we're doing.
So yeah. Well, we'd like to try. So about the committee or commission on the
advisory.
Advisory.
I don't know what it'll be called yet.
Okay. So is that something that people can apply to be on?
Yes, we don't have it posted yet, but I think if people are interested, please keep in touch with my council office, and we can go from there. We, of course, we want people who are interested in the topic, right? So we want don't want to force people to be on it, but we also want it to be a manageable size, right? I've been on committees, and I'm sure you have too, where you have 30 people in the room, and it's really hard to get an idea to go forward. So we haven't finalized what that structure will be yet, but we'll be coming out with something.
Let me ask one more quick question, and I know you can't talk about what went on in executive session, but when we were, Eric Walsh was doing his listening tours all over the place, and he was suggesting last night at a neighborhood meeting we were at that some things were going to change having to do with the city's relationship perhaps with neighborhoods, and the open meetings, the public access, really comes from you guys as a policy, but it also comes down from the city manager's office. Do you anticipate that the real push for open, more openness, more streaming, more public documentation available is going to be something that's going to be a priority from the city manager's office?
Well, you know, that administrative directive that I mentioned is going to be coming forward in the next few weeks. So during this transition period from our current city manager to our future city manager. And I for your viewers who may not be totally clear on this, so because of our form of government, where we've got the council and the city manager form of government, there is only so much the council can dictate in terms of what the city staff does. We direct the city manager, and the city manager will direct for staff, so it would be inappropriate for me to tell staff exactly what to do. That's why it's so important to have an overarching policy, right, that really speaks to this and then give feedback on how it's going through a citizens advisory committee. I think that's really what's going to help us. In terms of what I was looking for in the new city manager, absolutely a commitment to transparency and to engaging meaningfully, respectfully with the public was very important to me, and it was part of my evaluation. And I have to tell you, all the candidates expressed, even though I can't say what happened in executive session, all the candidates expressed a commitment to that. So.
Thank you. Is there anything else I should have asked?
Is there anything else you should have asked? No. You got it all.